Hey! What brings you around? Ooh, treading a little water here. Anyone have a life preserver? Oh, silly me. It's just one of my tablecloths. Completely forgot about that. Oh, so what's up, nerds and nerdettes and wee little nerdlings all? Your buddy Big Johnny G from Two Gun Pixie Presents Legendary Gaming is back once again! How's everyone doing? There I am, invading your computer, your precious time again, and what for? It's for a game. What the heck else do I come at you for? And today, talking about Forbidden Island! Oh! Forbidden Island is a game for 2 to 4 players. It's a game of exploration and discovery because you have to explore an island while it's sinking and try to get 4 treasures back to the starting point where your helicopter is and get the heck off the island before everything sinks. There's a little bit of tension in the game, I gotta say that. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna show you guys how to play. So why don't we get the board set up and we'll take a look. All right, so you have 24 tiles that come in the game, and you're going to set them up in this pattern. 2, 4, 6, 6, 4, 2. And it's going to form this diamond-like shape. Now, these are going to be shuffled before you put them out, so they can be placed randomly around the table. This way, every time you play the game, it's going to be a different layout, so it's going to be different ways to get to the different spots. You also have a set of flood cards, which you're going to shuffle these. And you're going to place them off to the side of the game. They have pictures of the tiles on them. And when you draw one of these, which in this case, this is the Whispering Garden. So let's find the Whispering Garden right here. If we drew this, what you would do is you're going to flip this to the watery looking side, signifying that this is starting to flood. But we'll get back to that in a moment. When we actually show how the game is played after the setup of the game. So you're going to shuffle these up. You're going to put them somewhere off to the side. And you also have treasure cards, which you're also going to shuffle and put to the side. The treasure cards include cards that have pictures of the 4 treasures. What are the 4 treasures that I'm talking about? You have the Earthstone treasure. You have the Statue of the Wind. The Crystal of Fire, and the Ocean's Chalice. Now, these are the 4 ancient relics that you are trying to find on this island, which has been designed to sink whenever anybody tries to come on the island. And you just came on the island. So, now also in the treasure cards, we're going to find this very important card, but you are not going to like it. Water Rises. When that card is drawn, your water level board. Now, if you're starting the game, you should start at the bottom for novice. You see it has several levels going up. But every time you draw one, you are going to tick this up further and further and further. If the game ever gets up to the top right here, that's one of the ways that you are going to lose the game as a team. This is a team cooperative game. So that's one of the ways. And also in the treasure deck I wanted to show off, they have some cards that say sandbag, and some cards that say helicopter lift. All right. Now, these are used during the game, and we'll get to that when we get to that, because they can be very important and life-saving cards that you can get. So you're going to set everything up. You're going to set up the cards, and then you're going to have to determine who is who. The game comes with 6 different characters that you can choose. The pilot, the messenger, the engineer, the diver, the explorer, and the navigator. You're going to choose these randomly. And each one has a different special ability. The pilot, once per turn, you may fly to any tile on the island for 1 action. That's very important because in the game you only have 3 actions that you can do. And every time that you move from one spot to another, that is 1 action. So the pilot is going to allow you to go from here all the way down to there if you want. And that's only going to be 1 action. Messenger, you can give treasure cards to a player anywhere on the island for one action. Normally in the game, your players have to be on the same tile in order to use an action to give something to someone. However, if you're playing the Messenger, you don't have to be on the tile. You can give it to anybody for that one action. The Explorer. The Explorer moves and can shore up diagonally. Remember, I showed you the shore up cards. Well, normally everything that happens in this game, unless you have a card like this that breaks the rules, you are only going to be moving sideways, up and down. You're not going to be moving diagonally at all. However, as you saw, this card here changes that. The Diver. The Diver may move through one or more areas that are flooded. And even missing tiles you can pass through. We're going to get to that because that's when the game gets really dangerous. But if you have the Diver is going to be able to move regardless of that. The Engineer can shore up to two tiles with just one action. So although although he can only still shore up, which is right next to him, either way, sideways or up and down, he can do it for two times for the one action, which definitely comes in very handy in the game. And then finally, there's the Navigator. You can move another player up to two adjacent tiles just for one action. So this way you're able to actually move other players on your turn, and that's a good way to set them up on their turn to do something easier. Maybe they didn't have quite enough actions to move and do something. Now that could probably help them. So these are the characters, and the game suggests to randomly draw from them, and that's great. We've done it both ways here. We've played randomly. We've played chosen. Sometimes we win. Sometimes we lose. It doesn't always change things. For this game, we're going to say, for this little walkthrough, we're going to say that the Diver, the Navigator, and the Engineer are the ones picked. Now, any of the cards that aren't picked, you can always use the back, because the back has this handy little cheat sheet, so to speak. It'll tell you exactly everything that you're going to be able to do during the game. So keep these handy. You don't necessarily have to put them back in the box unless you've played it enough times that you don't need it. But if you do need it, they're very handy to have. So you're going to take the pawns that represent your characters, such as the Diver. So we're going to have to find where the Diver goes. And that's what these little icons here are for. You see them all around on some of these tiles. On the Bronze Gate, the Silver Gate, the Iron Gate. Iron Gate. Now for the Navigator is yellow, so that will be the Gold Gate. And the Bronze Gate for the Engineer, who's red. Now the next thing that you're going to do is you are going to start the game off with six tiles that are already starting to flood. Let's get the game a little dangerous. So in this case, the Whispering Gardens, or which I used in the example, which is already starting to flood. Twilight Hollow. The Cliffs of Abandon. The Cliffs of Abandon. Abaddon. Abandon, I was right. There we go. The Misty Marsh. The Misty Marsh. Oop, all the way up top, opposite the cliffs. Is that five? That is five. That's four. So the fifth one, the Copper Gate. The Copper Gate. I thought I just saw that. Woo! Right next to the Navigator. One, two, three, four, five, and finally six. Oh, this is not good. This is not a good way to start, with Fool's Landing being one of the spots that is already starting to flood. Now, the reason this is not good is because this is another way you can lose the game. If Fool's Landing completely sinks, the game is over because you have no way of escaping. Because when you have the four treasures, all the players need to get back to Fool's Landing, and then one of them is going to have to play the helicopter card in order for everyone to escape. So we're going to take these off to the side because they are now discarded. And then each player is going to start with two treasures. Helicopter that sandbags, not bad. Crystal Fire. Ocean's Chalice. Statue of the Wind. And Ocean's Chalice. Now, during the setup, if you happen to draw a Water Rises card as one of your starting cards, simply put it off to the side and redraw until you don't get one. And then shuffle them all back in together again. So that they're all back in for the possibility of messing up your game with the sinking of the island. So now we have the board set up. We have the pieces and tiles all arranged. We have the characters picked out. You have your starting cards. And as I said before, you're going to want to start this at whatever level is convenient for you. Obviously, if it's the first time playing, you're going to want to start right there on Novice. Every time this clicks up, you're going to notice the watercolor gets darker and the numbers increase. That's very important in the game. We're going to get to that in a moment. So now the actual gameplay begins. And as I said, you can take up to 3 actions during this game. You can do each action multiple times as long as you're not doing a total of more than 3 actions. Such as in this case, the engineer could go 1, 2, and then use their sandbag card to save Fool's Landing. Because if another Fool's Landing came out while this was already flooding, the card would be gone. The tile is completely missing. Now, you don't move them back into place, because it's very important that you leave these sunken spots, because that is going to really determine how you are getting around the board and how you can get around the board. Another thing that you can do is you can give a treasure. So if the navigator, 1, 2, could then use the third turn to give one of the treasures to the engineer. Now this comes in handy because you can only hold 5 of these cards at a time. You can never have more than 5 cards. And you need 4 of a matching set in order to get that treasure. So if they were trying to get Ocean's Chalice, and the navigator went up and gave the engineer 1, and he had already had 3, he would have the 4 cards needed, and then he would have to get to one of these spots. There are 2, there are two spots that you can get each treasure. If both spots for a treasure, if both the Coral Palace and the Tidal Palace both ended up flooding and then sinking, the game would be over because it becomes impossible for you to get all 4 treasures. So you can only hold 5 cards in your hand at a time, and you need a matching set of 4 and to be on the tile in order to claim that. Now, when a tile disappears, when it gets flooded and you're on it, you have a chance. As long as there's another tile next to you, adjacent to you, again, not diagonally, unless, of course, you are the diver, who can go through multiple times, then you can actually swim for free to one of the land spots and prevent yourself from drowning. However, if you are stuck in a position like this, and there is no adjacent spot to go to, you drowned. And all it takes is for one of the players to drown, die, for the game to be over, because you have to win this game as a team. This is a fully cooperative game in that sense. So you have the cards, you have to make the matches, you have to use a set of 4, and you have to be on the exact area in order to do it. That is a very important part of the game. Now, when your turn is over, as I explained how to do your turn, how to move the act, how to use the actions for movement, for giving things, for collecting things, then the interesting part of the game happens. Because you look at this. Well, first you take the treasure. I always do that backwards. You get to take 2 treasure cards. Now, again, if you are at 5 already, or this puts you over 5, you're going to have to discard something from your hand. Then after you do that, you look at the number that you are currently at, in this case, 2. Because it's 2, you are going to then draw 1, 2 cards, and you're going to do what they say. So this is the Coral Reef and the Cave of Shadows. So the Coral Palace, I mean, not Reef, the Coral Palace is then going to become flooded. And if you draw it again, you take it away because it is completely sunk. And the Cave of Shadows. See, now this is bad. Remember, if this goes, you only have one other chance to get it. This is where shoring up becomes very important, because you want to make sure that areas that you can move freely through, areas that have the potential treasure, as well as Fool's Landing, never, ever sink. Now, let's say while you were drawing the cards, do it the easy way, you draw one of the Water Rises. When you draw that card, you immediately have three things that you have to do. And the card, yes, as you see, does tell you. So the first thing you're going to do is you're going to move this up to the next notch. Now, if it ends up moving you to a new number, remember, that's reflected by the number of cards you're going to have to draw from the flood deck. Now, the next thing that you have to do, is you've got to take the discard pile that you've already gone through from the flood deck, which means the cards that are already starting to flood, remember, are in this discard pile. You're going to shuffle up the discard pile as best as you can. And then you do not shuffle it into the remaining deck. It goes on top. You understand what that means. The cards that are already beginning to flood are going to be the next cards coming back out. So therefore, again, using sandbags to shore things up is highly important. And then you discard the Water Rises card. That's actually about it, I think. Right? That's about it. We got the cards. We got the rising board. We got the treasures. How the tiles work. Let me see if there's anything else I can't think of. No. Okay, so you're going to lose the game, remember, if Fool's Landing sinks. You're going to lose the game if one of you dies. You're going to lose the game if this reaches all the way up to that skull. Skulls do not usually mean anything good, do they? And certainly not in this case. And that's it. It's really that simple. There are not a lot of heavy rules to this game. Everything follows through, I think, pretty logically. And when you when you get all of these, if the island doesn't sink, remember, everybody has to be back on Fool's Landing. And then one of you plays the helicopter card. It doesn't matter who, it doesn't have to be the pilot, as long as one of you has that helicopter lift. So there's only one way to win, and you have several ways to lose the game. And the game is constantly shifting and changing between these cards, flooding, sinking, getting shorn up. It is not a static board, that's for sure. There's always change happening in this. And that's the game. That's how you play Forbidden Island. So let's go back up top. And that was it. Really is that simple. It's not a lot of heavy rules to this game. And as long as you play it logically, just follow through, everything makes a lot of sense. So this game is good for ages 10 and up. It takes about 30 minutes. And 2 to 4 players can rock this game out. Again, I would suggest if you're only playing 2 players, though, that you at least each of you uses 2 of the characters. We've had difficulty with 3 players in this game. 4 definitely seems to be the sweet spot. But try it with as many players as you can. And put a comment in the bottom and let us know how it worked with you and the number of players that you had. So thanks, everyone, for subscribing. If you did subscribe, if you didn't, hit that button. Give us a subscription. I'm Big Johnny G from Two Gun Pixie Presents Legendary Gaming. And friends, I am out of here.